So there's a big ceremony today. Nobel Prize, anyone? I mean, two people at DeepMind, your founder and the chief scientist, got the Nobel Prize. And you just flew in from Stockholm. Yes. I mean, is it life-changing?
Oh, it was surreal. It's such an exciting moment, not only for Demis and John, but I think for the team that worked on it. I definitely feel excited about that in the broader organization. And actually, in many ways, AI for science. You know, this is the first time in Nobel history that the committee has awarded an organization for the application of AI. And I think the fact that AlphaFold hasn't been around for very long. I mean, DeepMind's 14 years old. AlphaFold, we started hitting benchmarks about 4 years ago and a Nobel Prize already. So I think this is really showcasing that we can use AI as a new tool for discovery and we can have impact at a digital speed. So I think it's an exciting and important moment. And I think, yeah, just surreal, exciting.
and this is really like what you do at DeepMind. It's basically real life application.
Yes.
For the theory of AI. Where's it been most incredible to see it?
Oh, you know, we have such a diverse portfolio within Google DeepMind. So we work on generative AI, Gemini, of course, and generative AI, we power Google products. Also, we still believe that not just scaling data, but there's still breakthroughs to be had in generative AI. How do we get it to be more factual, grounded in think about reasoning and concepts? So there's memory. There's still quite a lot in order for AI to add value. We're in the very early days of generative AI. So we still do a lot of fundamental research. But then we also have this AI for science. And AlphaFold is really, I think, quite extraordinary. And yet we're doing work in weather forecasting last week. Actually, being an American, a Californian in London, I'm so excited about GenCast, which came out last week, which does state-of-the-art weather prediction for 15 days. So hopefully next the airlines will adopt it, and then my flights will run on time. But also a lot of the work around learning. I'm really excited about some of the learning science, material science, and discovering new materials. Last year we announced discovery from 40,000 to about 400,000 new materials, which now scientists are validating and thinking about how could we make new batteries to power electric vehicles. So I think we're in the very early stages of, I think, how AI can help us solve and address some of humanity's biggest challenges.
How do you measure success, and actually how do you prevent it from doing some of the bad things that we read about?
Oh, I think, you know, if I could wave a magic wand, I'd go back in time and say, like, let's actually rebrand this. I think artificial intelligence it sometimes overshadows, I think, what the technology is and what it's meant for. You know, at Google DeepMind, we believe that, you know, our mission is to build AI responsibly to benefit humanity. So the way I describe it is, like, what do? We build AI. We build the foundational models. How do we do it responsibly? And why do we do it? To benefit humanity. So we kind of keep, in my job as chief operating officer, is actually to make sure that we're doing that. And I think that if we can think about the application of AI and it starts to add value, then suddenly we don't call it AI anymore. If your phone battery lasts longer, that's adaptive battery, right? But there's AI charging that. Movie recommendations, song recommendations, maps, Google Translate. I mean, all of these are AI-powered tools, but we don't talk about them as being AI. So AI is around us everywhere. So I think if I take that and scale it, I feel like when we start talking more about the benefits and the features and how it's helping us, and we move away from just talking about risks, then I think we'll have made, that's what success looks like. But that takes earning people's trust. And that means building the technology with people and not having AI happen to them.
And in terms of disruption, is really science that you would be most proud of in terms of disrupting or advancing it, making it quicker to find cures?
Yeah, so maybe would it be helpful to give a little tutorial on AlphaFold?
Let's do it.
Feels kind of timely for today.
Yeah, 1 minute.
Okay.
Two minutes.
So Parkinson's. Alzheimer's, these are all protein-based diseases. There's a 50-year grand challenge in trying to understand how a structure of a protein, how it folds. If you can do that, you can understand its function. If it misfolds, you can understand what's wrong. AlphaFold, we were able to fold all 250 million known proteins to humankind. That means, and then provided in an open database for scientists to use. There are 2.2 million researchers using this database. I didn't even know there were 2 million people watching proteins. And it used to take scientists 4 years of like a PhD to do a single protein. So that's almost like advancing the field of biology about a billion years if we do crude math. But why that's important is we can understand diseases, we can do better therapeutics, food security. Why are some plants more resistant to disease than others? Plasticating enzymes, dealing with industrial waste. These are also protein-based problems. So there's a lot of work happening. So to your point, if we can use AI for scientific discovery, much like we use a microscope or a telescope to understand the world around us in a new way, that's how we're hoping we can now have scientific breakthroughs at digital speed, but do it with the scientific community, because our expertise is machine learning, and we really need to take a collaborative approach. This isn't about any one company or any one country.
I mean, it's pretty incredible that you're also based in the UK.
Yes.
Has that changed your perspective on things?
Absolutely. You know, I've spent 30 years at the intersection of technology and social impact. In fact, I'm an electrical engineer by training and a semiconductor engineer. So I spent most of my career in the US, but also 6 years in Asia. And so when I first took this role, I'm like, why am I moving to London to work in the tech sector on AI? I could stay here in Silicon Valley. But what I have found is very unique about being in London is the fact that there's so much cultural diversity and ethnic diversity as well. And I think you bring that into work every single day. You know, even just the blue plaques with the history, you're just reminded of everything that has happened here. And even our conference rooms are named after philosophers and scientists. And it's a kind of paying respect to all the rich history around here. And I think, again, you just bring that in. So you're thinking long term, and you can take ambitious goals like AlphaFold versus worrying about who got funded, who's moving to which new startup, and instead say, okay, we're really trying to benefit humanity. What are the biggest problems that we can work on and solve and apply the scientific method to do that?
Lila, a lot of the businesses will be thinking, like, how do I use this? What are the pitfalls? What should I worry about? How are you seeing businesses experiment with AI?
Yeah, we're seeing a lot in, first of all, my advice is always use it as quickly as you can. Start using this. Like, people are waiting and thinking they have time. You don't have time. So I think really leaning into the learning opportunity. So one thing I actually started doing was just asking my team members at all levels in the organization how they're using it. And I was really surprised and started to shine a spotlight on them and to spread it. So obviously we've had this technology in our hands for quite a while before we release it. But finding, you know, the market analyst who is using this to quickly summarize some of the press reports and being then able to add her own expertise layered onto that. Our legal team, which gets so many inquiries, so even within the organization, and how they're using this as kind of an internal customer service. You know, there's a lot around general productivity of what we're doing. And so I think even if you're not full scale adopting it yet, starting to experiment, because you'll never have as much time and freedom to experiment as you do now. And it's a good chance to really kind of encourage folks to find new ways to make AI beneficial internally.
So what does this look like in 5 years? I mean, at DeepMind, does it mean, you know, fewer lawyers, less accountants, less programmers, or more programmers?
Yeah, actually what we're doing is saying, where do we need the human expertise, that nuanced understanding, and really apply it more towards the frontier of the work, and how do we start automating or triaging some of the lower level work? You know, as someone who, again, has kind of, you know, we all kind of go through our career. So the early stage, you want people to still have opportunities to learn. So we look at this as not necessarily replacing the human work that needs to be done, but rather augmenting and being able to scale.
What risks do you think about? What do you really worry about with AI?
Yes, I think AI could be one of the most transformational technologies of our time. In fact, I have to tell you, sitting in Stockholm, I'm like, I think it is. You know, and having worked on computing and the internet build out, I really do believe we're in a new era of discovery with AI. And but I think about risk a lot, right? It keeps me up at night, both the opportunity and the risk. And we think about risk across in a continuum of near-term risks like misinformation and bias. We think about misuse, cybersecurity as an example, and long-term risk, existential risk. Who's in control of this? Whose values are they? Are they aligned to human values, et cetera? And then we think about it in terms of, do we have the right internal governance in place? Not just process for process sake, but are we like having the right multidisciplinary approach, asking the questions, quickly learning, iterating, because you can't have all the answers. Do we have the right type of responsibility research? And that could be everything from what we do from a technical safety to thinking about socio-technical topics, decolonial AI, LGBTQ, fairness, thinking about things like the ethics of AI assistance, like years before we have the technology ready. And then we think about how do we deploy this. So in the case of AlphaFold, actually, we said this could take away jobs from biologists and scientists. So before we, and what risks are there, bioharms that might come from making this widely available? Like, so we consulted outside experts, and actually we knew we had inside bias. So we brought in outside experts, consulted them, and decided that we would release the database in partnership with the European Bioinformatics Lab because they have the ecosystem and know how to do this. And so I think thinking about responsible deployment, how do you release technology in a way where you're, again, doing it with communities rather than to communities? And in fact, we put an extra effort into work with the Global South to ensure that where they didn't have the knowledge or the technology, or that now we've done onboarding to help ramp them up. And about a third of the database users are actually coming from the Global South.
But Lila, how difficult is it to say, well, this is what I don't want AI to do, and then shape AI so that you move away from that? Is that the right way of thinking about how to structure it going forward?
Yeah, there's some that we can do that, right, in terms of policies and filters. But you also have to be careful because, you know, what you think may be right or wrong is maybe different than me. Yeah. So we spend, there's different political views, there's different cultural views. And when you have a technology like a generative AI, it's something that's available globally instantaneously. So there's a lot of deliberation in about how to make this, how to do this. And it's not just like you can't build a generative AI and then any type of AI and then at the end say, oh, we're going to make it responsible now. It's like building a car and adding a seatbelt at the end. Instead, it has to be built in from the beginning. And so even drawing hard lines is a very difficult thing. So it's extraordinarily nuanced, and it really does require diverse thought around the table.
Has the adoption of AI gone quicker than you thought when you joined
DeepMind? Absolutely. I thought I joined a research organization, and you know, my job is to oversee the operations, our responsibility in frontier safety work, and then how we all of our external collaborations and policy work. And I, in a research organization, that's quite different than now we're the engine room of Google, and in parallel doing all our work around science. I don't know if I didn't expect that society would accept this technology so quickly. And so we are, in many ways, now accelerating research to make sure that the technology we're releasing can meet the expectation, and we feel we need to earn the trust of the citizens, and that really requires us doing a lot of listening as well, and understanding what are people's hopes and fears, and ensuring that we can bring that into the early stages of the research and the development.
And given your background, you think about biases in AI.
Yeah.
How do you tackle that?
Well, I'm a child of immigrants, and English was my second language, and I grew up in middle America where I was the dark kid, and then I lived in Japan where I was the weird foreigner in a city of 40,000 people. And then, you know, a lone electrical female engineer in my university classes. So I think I got very comfortable at a very young age being an outsider. But what that has meant throughout my entire career in semiconductors, sector, in venture capital, and in startup world is that I'm always looking at how do we make sure those outside voices are brought into the technology development. You know, we need that to happen. So how can we have the technology? So I'm spending a lot of my effort right now making sure that we're meeting with civil rights activists, people with disabilities, business leaders, and helping to share our AI understanding and expertise, looking around the corner with them so they can take it into their communities and we can learn from their hopes and dreams. And I think this is the most important thing. I feel incredibly humbled and fortunate. I am in this role and this time in history. And I'm like, what am I going to do with it? Is this going to be a legacy worth living? And it will matter if I can make sure that we're developing AI more responsibly.
Lila, thank you so much for your time today. Lila Ibrahim there.
Thank you.